Okay, so what you're about to listen to is bits and pieces of an interview I had done 2 years ago with Sarah Cracknell from Saint Etienne, and it was for the last time they came and played in LA. And what happened was I interviewed them for a local magazine. I interviewed her for a local magazine, and there was just a tiny little bit of part of the interview that actually made it into the piece. And I always felt like there was more, and I always felt bad that nothing ever happened with it. So I'm trying to, I wanted to take parts out, it's particularly parts where she talks about certain Saint Etienne songs that I kind of tricked her into talking about a little bit. I said they were Saint Etienne classics and the fans would like to know more about them, but really what they were my favorite songs. So I thought she had some interesting things to say. So we put together a little visual presentation for you to watch while she talks about these songs, and I hope you enjoy it.
Roll the tape.
So funny. It was just yesterday. I was on the internet and I found a video clip of you and Tim Burgess. I think, God, it must have been from 1994, doing "I Was Born on Christmas Day," and you had a big white feather boa and you wrapped it around him. I think the show is called The Word or something. I can't
quite... Oh God, yeah, we were terrible.
Yeah, but you were having fun.
We were having great fun, but the reason we looked like we were having such great fun is because on stage we sounded great. And it wasn't. I've only ever watched half of it because I couldn't bear how out of tune we sounded on the telly. And we got on stage, we sounded fantastic. That's why we looked like we were having such a great time. We were thinking, we are the gods, we are kings, we are great, you know.
Oh,
and then when we actually heard it back on telly, it was like, oh no, we sound terrible.
Just for the article, kind of tell the story of how you came to be in the band.
Well, Bob and Pete had known each other since they were little kids, and they did that Neil Young cover, "Only Love Can Break Your Heart," and they kind of did it in the studio, mucking around. And Jeff Barrett released it, and it became very successful. So it's sort of underground, kind of in the dance scene or whatever, but very successful. And I heard that record and loved it. And then they had Kiss and Make Up, and on both those records they had different singers. And then the third single was going to be Nothing Can Stop Us. And we met through a sort of mutual, it was actually Bob's girlfriend at the time, who I knew from Windsor, where I grew up. And she played, quite funny, actually, she played him a record, it's like a dance record, a techno thing, where I was actually speaking in Spanish on this record. So I don't know, but from that, they seemed to think I might be a good choice, but I don't know why. And we met up, and we just got on very well, we sort of clicked, you know?
Yeah.
One of those weird things. Because I think their plan was to have different singers on everything.
Yeah.
And to put an album together of tracks all with different vocalists and whatever. But once I'd done Nothing Can Stop Us, I sort of went and did another track and another track, and it just sort of progressed from there. And they just couldn't shake me off, basically.
Were you flattered when Kylie went and covered that song?
Yeah, I really was, and it's a shame nothing much happened with it because I thought she did it so well. I remember being in the studio and her being a bit kind of like didn't really want to do the talking bit and was saying, "Why don't you to me? You know, why don't you do the talking bit and I'll do this?" And I was going, "No, no, you can do that. You'll sound great. Don't worry." You know, and trying to encourage her to do it just the way it had, you know, that we'd done it ourselves. And I thought she did a great job. And it's a shame that we didn't hear more of that record, but
yeah.
Hey. But no, we were very flattered.
Very cool. There's this rumor out there. Is this kind of just folklore then about Bob and Pete hearing you singing in a McDonald's bathroom?
Popular urban myth. Yeah, I'm afraid. I could have told you that story, but I told you the truth.
You told me the truth. Okay,
yeah.
Great. I picked out songs here that I kind of think are Saint Etienne anthems, and I was just wondering, I'm gonna mention them, if you could kind of just give like a little anecdote about them or whatever each of these songs.
Whatever I can remember.
Yeah, see any memories these bring up. We'll start with Join Our Club.
Oh, Join Our Club. Do you really like that?
Oh, I love that song.
That was the one thing about that record was that it was very much misinterpreted in this country by the music press here.
Okay.
They saw it as being very elitist, like, you know, if you don't know about this, then you can't be in our gang, and if you don't know about this, because we know about this, then you're not clever like us. And they saw it as being really elitist. But the actual sentiment of the song, Join Our Club, was meant in a very positive way. Very much about, we found this brilliant record, or we found this brilliant band, or we know about this brilliant thing, why don't you come and share it with us, it's so great. And that was what the song was about, and it was kind of misinterpreted, which was a bit of a shame, but only by the, you know, any nasty old journalist at the NME.
I heard she drove the silvery sports car along the empty streets last night.
Let's move on to Hobart Paving.
Hobart Paving is one of the songs I love singing. We so often do it at gigs. But funny enough, I probably won't at this next gig, this next tour. Well, you never know, we might do, but I've just done it, I've sung it so many times.
Right.
We never quite pull ourselves away from it, you know, it's got such a hold on us. Plus, I've been asked to sing it so many times, I haven't, luckily, but
right.
People's weddings and things like that. Please come and sing that song at my wedding. Oh, God, no.
How funny.
But no, I love that. So I remember doing the video for that. That was Paul Kelly.
Oh, okay.
Who was the director of Sinister.
He's on the phone.
He's on the phone. Came about because of Etienne Dao, you know, the French singer. And it's his tune. He had a hit in France with a song called Weekend at Home, and it became He's on the Phone. We just changed all the words and made it our own song.
Okay.
And that became quite a big sort of gay anthem, I thought. The thing is, people sort of talk to me about, you know, how much I listen to music at the moment, and I've got to be perfectly honest, because I don't want to go all bang on about the fact that I've got kids, but I do have two little boys, one who's 4 and one who's 18 months old. I never get a chance to listen to music until they've gone to bed.
Aww.
Mind you, I mean, I listen to music with them, but my eldest one tends to dictate what we listen to, and he really likes kind of chart stuff. He loves things like Sugar Babes and Pharrell Williams and what else does he loves really funny things like, you know, that I can't remember the name of the group, but My Humps, you know.
Black Eyed Peas.
You know, so I have to listen to things like that all the time. I end up, you know, dancing around the kitchen with him, going, my hands, my lovely lady, lots of things. Thinking, what the hell am I doing? He gets very confused, though. You know, he sort of hears mummy singing, and then we're listening to the radio, and there'll be, I don't know, a Robbie Williams track on the radio or something. And they go, is that you, mummy? No. Man.
That's great.
It gets